Hello, Campbell.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
No meaning, mining, no. Everybody's good. Everybody's ready for summer. Yeah.
So they're catering all the food. would love to stress, if you look at your notes, you'll see right there in like big bold letters, in the middle of that paragraph, it says we need auction items. It's bolded and capitalized for a very good reason, because people, we need auction items. Every single student who intends to go to camp is required to offer some sort of auction item. And these auction items are going to come in the form of a gift or a service of type. So all sorts of students offering cleaning houses or washing cars or babysitting, or maybe they're baking a pie or they're making all sorts of stuff. Every single student is required to provide an auction item. So there's going to be plenty, but we can use all of them more. In the past, we've had fishing trips and airplane rides and all sorts of crazy fun stuff. And I want to say this because, you know, this is the most cliche, be careful what you ask for, but I will say that if there is something that you want to give, it's not necessarily a service, but it's something that, cool item or something like that you want to put in auction, go for it. Like, really, truly, really go for it. But we're trying our hardest to maintain the idea that this auction is really an auction for goods and services, time to spend with one another, or things that you can do for one another, and that's really what we're aiming for. So if there's something that you want to auction off, and there's not currently, but I promise you there will be down in the lobby, a paper that you can put your name on and just say, this is what we're offering, this is what we're auctioning off, and so that will be available to you out in the lobby after the service. Other than that, Vacation Bible School, June 12th through the 16th. If you have a desire to sign up, if you have a desire to volunteer, there's a sign up sheet out in the lobby. We could use all the help in the world. That is an incredibly busy and popular thing that we have at this church, and we need all the help we can possibly get. So, with that being said, let us pray, and we'll get started with this morning's worship. Father, Lord, I thank you so much for how good you are, how good you continue to be. Lord, every day I find new ways to praise you. I find new things that you have done. Continue to amaze me, Lord. Lord, we are a people who are just incredibly thankful for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for the way in which you have made us right with you. And I pray that if that truth has not gripped every single person in this room, if there are people here today that have not had their lives changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ, Lord, I pray that this very day that it would, that it would change their hearts and change their eternal destinations forever. But we love you. Teach us to love you all the more. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Stand as we
with the kids that are bigger than you.
Don't forget three.
Exactly. And the Bible says, by the way you live, be an example to other people. Now, you may be an example to your parents. Likely, you're an example to another high school graduate, or you're an example to another kid at preschool. But the way you live is an example to others in how you should live and how you should treat others. And even though you're young, God wants you to live for Him so that others can see God living in you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these boys and girls, and thank you for these young men and women. Lord, thank you for all they mean to our church. Lord, for all they mean to each other. Lord, I know these boys and girls look up to these kids in high school, these young people getting out of high school, and just pray that wherever we are in life, as your word is taught us, help us to live for you and set an example for others. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Tell you what, boys and girls, let me go back to your seat. Tell you what, high school grad, won't y'all just sit on that front row?
Christians who grew up in the churches and in their communities, they go off and they abandon the faith. But I look at you, and there's just a tremendous confidence that I have in each and every one of you, and in your faith, and in your love for Jesus. And I'm not filled with nervousness or fear of watching you go off and do whatever it is you hope to do. Instead, I have just an incredible excitement for each and every one of you. And so, so proud of all of you. I'm excited to have this day and this opportunity to recognize each of you. There's the verse that you've heard me say time and time again. It is the verse that I read to every single one of our seniors. And you've heard me read it at our senior lunch. You hear me read it again. But it is this, Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 9. Young people, it is wonderful to be young. Enjoy every minute of it. Do everything you want to do. Take it all in, but remember that you must give an account to God for everything you do. So when you go into this world, when you go into this life, this new, big, grand life of yours, do everything. Have all the fun in the world, but remember your Savior, remember Jesus Christ. He loves you and cares for you. He's bigger than life. Love him instead of that big old world. Now, that said, let's recognize these seniors and congratulate each and every one of them. Now, firstly, we have Ms. Lindsay Bazell, daughter of Jason and Carla Bazell. Lindsay here intends to go to Texas A&M, where she plans to pursue a bunch of cultists, I swear. Plans to go to Texas A&M and pursue a career in pharmacy. Yes. So I think we're going to take a ticket. We're going to stay all up here until everyone's up here, and we're going to take a before picture. Secondly, Ms. Natalie Crawley, daughter of Andrew and Andrew. Natalie's been on over to TJC, where she will pursue a career in psychology. Astronomy. Fourthly, Mr. Chris Hale, son of David and Christy Hale. He too will be headed on over to that little school, Texas A&M, where he will be pursuing a career in philosophy. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Caleb Ramsey, son of Ryan and Heather Ramsey. He will be headed to UT Tyler and pursuing a career in kinesiology.
Every year, our church offers two scholarships to graduating seniors. There's the Laura B. Folsom Scholarship and the Dr. M.A. King Scholarship. And we offer both of these scholarships to the students who we feel throughout the time here at FSC Franklin has just served faithfully, loyally, exhibit outstanding Christian character, behavior. And so with that, we nominate two seniors here today to receive these scholarships. So, with that being said, in honor of the Laura B. Colson Scholarship, this year, we award this scholarship to Ms. Lindsay Bazell. And then in honor of the Dr. M.A. King Scholarship, this year, we gladly award this to Mr. Ryan. All right, one more hand for our graduating seniors.
scripture that Jesus said in Acts 1:8 is true, as it was back then, as it is today. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. I know Jesus said in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria, but you know what he means. He means the entire world. So go out and be witnesses for Jesus Christ in this new season of your life and all of your lives. We're going to sing a song we did last week. We did this one leader congregation response. I think we did really well last week. We're going to try it again, but we're going to review the chorus real quickly if you would stand. And it goes like this. It goes, pass the promise to our son.
Thank you. us a sovereign and who's glorified in your name.
There are a lot of jokes out there about marriage. I mean, believing the material is everywhere. But it's not really a jokey matter. I can tell you, it's a lot of fun, but it's not a joke. It's serious business. It's God's business. Now, I'm sure the graduates are thinking, hey, it's senior recognition Sunday. What in the world are we going to talk about there? You would come expecting to hear a sermon about reaching your goals or God being the strength and the guide for your life and all of those things. But let me tell you how this is going to fit pretty well. Young people, graduates, older teenagers, marriage will quite likely be the most important decision you will make in the next 10 years of your life. And it is also, of all the things in life, over the next 10 years of your life, it will have, the decision you make there will have the greatest bearing on your happiness and your fulfillment in life. I mean, really, all the people I should be talking about marriage to is the young people. So many times we talk to folks after the fact about decisions in life, significant parts of life. We really ought to talk to people before those decisions as they look ahead, as they prepare, as they consider what marriage is all about. And I guess the greatest place we should go and look is simply to ask this question: what did Jesus say about marriage? And there's a passage recorded in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19. It's also recorded in Mark, chapter 10. But where Jesus spoke the most about marriage, and we're going to find in Matthew's version. Matthew, chapter 19, beginning verse 1. And this teaching about marriage from Jesus comes under the most strange and curious circumstances. Because the reason that Jesus began to teach and talk about marriage here is because the religious leaders asked him about divorce. And here's what Matthew records about that day. When Jesus had finished saying these things, he left Galilee and went into the region of Judea to the other side of Jordan. Large crowds followed him, and he healed them there. Some Pharisees came to him to test him. They asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason?" And then here's Jesus' reply. "Haven't you read," he replied, "that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female, and said, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate." Amen. Now, as much as the ideas and beliefs about marriage and divorce can be controversial today, they were even more controversial in the life of certain first century Jews. Within the Jewish world and within the Jewish faith, marriage was always held in the highest regard. So therefore, it's very strange that in the day that Jesus was on the earth and teaching, that in many cases, a Jewish man can divorce his wife for almost any reason. Now, God's word has already spoken about divorce and marriage in the very creation story throughout the Old Testament. What happened within the Jewish belief is there were rabbis. The rabbis were the religious leaders of the Jews. And the rabbis would take the Old Testament scriptures, would take God's word, would take the
century Palestine, there were two prevailing rabbi schools that particularly commented on marriage and divorce. One was the school of Shammai. The rabbi's name was Shammai. And the school of Shammai was very conservative. It was very strict. It held to the Old Testament teaching and the Old Testament law, and it simply proclaimed this, that the only valid, the only legal reason for divorce was infidelity, unfaithfulness. If the wife had been unfaithful to her husband, committing adultery, that was the only valid reason. And now you might say, oh, Pastor Kelly, why didn't you just say wife? It's an inappropriate thing to say, certainly for today. It's something I would not say myself and I would disagree with. But for a first century Jew, that was the case. Only the man had any say. Only the man could file for divorce. Only the man could make any decision related to marriage. So whatever the man did, the woman couldn't do anything about it. But what the woman did, the man could do something about it. And for the school of Shammai, this is the only reason, the only valid reason you can divorce your wife is if she's been unfaithful to you sexually. Well, that's exactly what Jesus had already taught in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5. Did you know that was in the Sermon on the Mount? A little bit section, two verses. Jesus says that God's design for marriage is to be lifelong, and the only reason, the only acceptable reason for divorce is because of marital sexual unfaithfulness. But then there was the school of Hillel. Hillel was the rabbi, and there were those that followed Hillel. It was very lenient. And this rabbi, Hillel, had taken the scriptures, and somehow he interpreted the Old Testament scriptures and talked about a man's happiness or a man's unhappiness, and he began to list the reasons that a man could divorce his wife. One reason was talking to another man in public. Another reason, speaking to his parents disrespectfully. Another reason, burning his food. Funny. It's true. Written in Jewish books of history, those that study the old writings of the rabbinic school of Hillel, one of the reasons listed that a man could file for divorce on his wife is that she wasn't a good cook or she burned his supper. And the reality was, the school of Hillel, the lenient, liberal, not based on scripture view, was the popular and prevailing thought in the world at this time. That kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? And in the midst of this environment, in the midst of this atmosphere, the Pharisees caught Jesus and always tried to discredit Jesus, always tried to throw Jesus into controversy. They said, hey, Jesus, is it true that a man can divorce his wife for any reason? No matter what answer Jesus was going to give, he was going to make somebody mad. No matter what answer Jesus was going to give, he was going to create this tremendous controversy that was going to be all over. And this is how Jesus answered. Jesus was an incredible teacher. The wisdom of Jesus is the wisdom of God. Of course. And this is how Jesus answered their question. He said, let me remind you, men. Why don't you think back about what God gave us a long time ago?
2. Well, let's start with chapter 1, verse 27. The first thing Jesus did was he quoted Genesis, the creation story, 1:27. He said this: "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." Now, today, in our modern culture, we need to once again have someone tell us, don't you recall what God has already given us? Don't you recall what God has already said? Male and female, he created them. There's only two categories. And doctors in delivery rooms have known it and written it on certificates for centuries. You're either male or female. And it's determined when you're born, or if you have the right medical equipment, it's determined before you're born. If the reading medical is right. From the point of conception, you're either male or you're female. And when Jesus was answering the question about marriage and divorce, the first thing he did is he quoted Genesis 1:27, God created them, male and female. Haven't you guys heard that already? And then he quoted Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. That word, we were in this word 2 weeks ago when we started this series on the family, God's design for the family. That word, that statement, is the foundational plan, the foundational design for all of human society. That God created this male and female, that a man would marry a woman, and within that union of the man and woman, a family would be born out of that. That is God's design. It is the basis. It is the first and greatest institution given to us by God, and is the foundation of all human society. Now, I'm also going to remind you, the verse that follows, verse 24, is a simple little verse. It seems a bit out of context, but it has great significance. Verse 25, the man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Now, there's some significant teaching to do within that, because do you know, I'm going to stop for just a second, because, since we're talking about sex, I guess I'm do you know what the most common word is in the Bible for human response to the realization of sin? Shame. That's a biblical word. Somebody say, well, I wasn't ashamed. It was because you didn't know it was sin. The only reason somebody's not ashamed is because they didn't know it was sin, or they don't care what God thinks. Those are the two reasons you're not ashamed. But when the Bible refers to a human being believing that God is real and recognizing that I have sinned, the biblical word is shame. It's significant then, in the story of creation, when God designed marriage, what followed the truth they said for this reason, a man will leave his mother and father to be united to the wife, and the two will become one flesh. We discover God's foundational building blocks for marriage. And I'm going to tell them very quickly. Number one, it says maturity. First thing it says, a man will be his father and mother. When does a young person leave their father and mother? When they're mature enough to leave home. He will leave his mother, he will depart. The very first building block of God's plan for marriage is that you're mature enough to get married. There are two aspects of maturity. One is emotion. What is the prevailing attitude of a child?
immaturity is selfishness. It's all about me. The prevailing quality that marks then emotional maturity is unselfishness. I have learned that other people are more important or as important as I am. And I've learned that this life is about loving and serving other people. So before someone is ready to get married, they have to reach a level of maturity that says, I'm going to love and care for another human being more than myself. Their needs matter more than my needs. That is emotional maturity. The second aspect of maturity is material. Money. Can you support yourself? A man will leave his mother and father. Why? Because he doesn't need his mother and father's money anymore. He doesn't need his mother and father's house anymore. He will leave his mother and father because he's reached the point of financial independence. He's got an education. He's trained for a career. He has a career path. He has a job. He can pay the bills. That's what maturity is. It is emotional maturity that says I can love another person more than I love myself. And it's material maturity that says I can support myself and support another person. That's the beginning point of being ready to be married. Maturity, I would tell you. Couples that get married, if you got to live with your mom and dad, then you're too young to get married. You get married when you go get your own house, your own apartment, you pay your own bills, all of that, and you have a steady regular income. That's when you're mature enough to get married. The story goes up. Young man was married a fellow's daughter. So the dad, the daughter's dad, went to the young man and said, son, do you think you can support a family? And he said, well, sir, I'm not sure about that. I can support your daughter, but the rest of it are on your own. Well, that's what it's about, young man. You support your wife. The rest of the family's on their own. But number one, maturity. Man will leave his mother and father. Number two is unity. Man will leave his mother and father and be united to his wife. Well, the key to understand is the Hebrew word that's translated united to. You see, there's a lot of things that we can get united about. We get united about sports teams. We all wear the same colors. We have chants and things. We get united over campaigns, fundraising campaigns, political campaigns. And there's all this kind of temporary unity based on circumstances and causes. That's not the word. The Hebrew word that gets translated, be united to your wife, is the word which literally means be bonded together. Be welded together. That's what the word means. To be united is to be bonded permanently. There is no other meaning for this word here, united. Two things have been bonded into one thing permanently. Are you familiar with the movie? Just drew a blank. You know, let's say Fireproof. You know, there's a bunch of Church of Georgia make all the great Christian movies. One of their early movies in the series is Fireproof, and the story is about a fireman. Kirk Cameron played the fireman. And he and his wife were having troubles. I think she was a pharmaceutical salesman. She was flirting with the doctors. He was looking at stuff on the internet and she didn't look at, and movies depicting all this, and their marriage is crumbling, and their marriage is going downhill. And one day he's sitting in the fire station, and there was a friend, a little bit older mentor in the fire department, he's talking to him, he's talking about his struggles with his wife. And the scene in the movie goes that this other fireman reached across the kitchen table at the firehouse and grab the plastic salt and pepper shaker. You know these plastic salt and pepper shakers.
And he dug around in the drawer and pulled out some super glue, and he took the super glue and he ran a bead of super glue right down on the salt pepper shaker, and he took the other one and he held them together and held them for about a minute. And if you put a bead of super glue right there, it's going to be pretty strong. And then he took these, bonded together, and he handed them to the Kirk Cameron character, and he said, "Hey, tear them apart." Well, if these two plastic salt and pepper shakers were super glued together, and he gave them to a grown man, and he said, "Tear them apart," is he going to be able to do it? Yes. But what's going to happen? The plastic's going to break. The super glue's not going to break. The bond is not going to break. The plastic. And so in the movie, he pow, one of the salt pepper crumbles into 50 pieces, and salt pepper goes everywhere because he broke the bond. The word in Genesis, be united to his body, is a word that literally means permanently bond together, just like the salt pepper shaker. We know it's possible to break it apart. We know divorce is a reality. We know divorce is legal. But you are breaking a bond that God did not intend to be broken, and whenever you do that, it is destructive. God's idea: one man, one woman, permanent union. Whenever I'm working with a young couple getting ready to get married, one thing we talk about, let's get your wedding vows, man. You have your choice. Last line of the vows. Here's your choice. You get to pick. You can either say, "Till death do us part," or "As long as we both shall live." Whichever way you want to say it, it means the same thing. God's design for marriage is till death would do us part, or as long as both of us continue living. Number one, maturity. Number two, unity. Number three, spirituality. It says, they will become one flesh. What a strange concept. They will be made into one. When Paul referenced this in Ephesians, Paul has the most writing about marriage in the New Testament. When Paul referenced this, Paul talked about they will become one flesh. You remember what Paul added? Paul added, and this is a great mystery. Why? Because the Spirit. If God is the designer of marriage, if this was God's plan for humanity from the very beginning, do you not think it has a spiritual component to it? When a husband and a wife commit their lives to one another, there's an emotional bonding, there's a physical bonding, and there's a spiritual bonding. The two shall become one flesh. And in fact, Jesus is quoting this in Matthew 19 when he's answering the Pharisee's question. He's quoting it and he says, be united to his wife and the two will become one flesh. And then Jesus adds, he adds on to Genesis 2:24, verse 6 of Matthew 19. Jesus says, so they are no longer two, but one. From God's perspective, that couple who marries in Christ under God, God now sees them as one. Now, they're still two individuals. They still personally relate to God, individually relate to God. Every part of their life before is still there, every part of their personality, all of their talents, all of their uniqueness. You're still completely the unique person you were created to be. But suddenly, God sees you. Bond is united with another person. An example of that. This past Wednesday, we had a business meeting. We had it once a month. One of the documents we have at business meeting is the agenda. It's going to happen. Another document we have is the minutes from the previous meeting. I'll tell you what else. We, in that office, we have the fanciest machine.
Let me tell you what this machine can do. You can take one document, and you take another document, and put them together. And you stick them in that machine. And if you punch the right series of buttons, those two documents will come out as one document. Have you ever seen that before?
We had one page that was said, this is the business meeting agenda. We had another page that said, this is the minutes from the meeting right before. But you know, we saved a lot of paper. And we printed one on that front and one on that. But you know what? We didn't lose anything. Every word, every sentence, every idea, everything is still there. But the two shall become one. Feather right now, you would say, Anthony, you would say, hand me those pages. Your pages. We say, hand me that page. It's one page now. And we see it as one page. It's one page in front and back. What used to be two is now one. And it's permanently one. It's a great mystery. But Jesus said, they are no longer two, but one. Finally, lastly, maturity, unity, spirituality, and sexuality. The man and his wife are both naked and they felt no shame. Physical expression of this spiritual oneness, this love, is a gift of God and it is expressly designed and intended for marriage. Sex is a great and marvelous gift that enhances your marriage and fulfills your life. But God's design is that sexuality would be expressed within the union of marriage. God's fourfold, four-block foundation for marriage is found in Genesis 2, 24 and 25. It will never change. That a young man and a young woman are both mature enough to depart home and be emotionally mature to care for each other and earn a living on their own. They are to be permanently bonded as a union until death do them part. They are to be spiritually bound together only by Heavenly Father. And the sexual expression they share and enjoy together is within the marriage that they share together. He's helped you out a little bit. God's word says it. But pastor, I look all around me and say, somehow that's not working. I know a lot of people that are divorced. I know a lot of my grandparents are divorced. In fact, some people say, oh, my parents are divorced. It's easy to say, I'm seeing that this really isn't working. It's interesting to note, I will tell you this, that just slightly, over the last 10 years, the divorce rates have gone down, which is good. But at the same time, the marriage rates have gone down. Less people are getting married, don't they? Less people are getting married, then I guess less people are getting divorced. Guess what statistics going up? What they call cohabitation. That going up. I guess you can't get divorced if you never got married. But you know what statistics say? This living together doesn't enhance any future marriage. In fact, statistics say that living together actually makes the marriage, if it would happen, more fragile. God always knew this. Real quick. Wrap it up. Pastor, how am I going to know something? The story about a man on an airplane is flying along. He looks up at a man sitting next to him. He notices that the man has his wedding ring on his index finger. And he says, hey, buddy, you got your wedding ring on the wrong finger. And his reply, yeah, I married the wrong woman. That attitude is more common than you think. People that are into a marriage, and then they suddenly say, I'm married the wrong person. I'm married to the wrong woman. I'm married to the wrong man.
So then the question is, how do you know you're marrying the right person? Young people, I'm going to really listen to this, but really all husbands and wives, listen. How do you know you're marrying the right person? This will carry you a long way. It's more important to be the right person than to marry the right person. You see, selfishness says, I'm going to find the right person. I'm going to find the perfect person. And in reality, if you would be the right person, you wouldn't have to worry about it so much. God's call in our life is to be the right person. To be faithful, to be godly, to be caring, to be loving. To be that right person and let God take care of your future. In the first century Jewish world, almost every marriage was arranged. Two people getting married didn't have any say in it at all. It was either arranged by parents or it was arranged by professional matchmakers. And the fact is, in the Orthodox Jewish world, the Hasidic Jewish world, it's still true today. These are all arranged marriages. And there is something true about human nature. I would have never picked that person. My mom and dad picked that person for me. A professional matchmaker picked that person for me. But there is a truth about human nature. If you treat a person like they're the right person, they will likely end up being the right person. And if you treat a person, even the ideal person, if you treat a person like the wrong person, you will likely see them as the wrong person. Don't put so much emphasis on finding the right person as being the right person. This in closing, simple truths. God's plan, God's design for your marriage is exactly this: a husband and wife committed for life, sharing all of life. There's a simple word that carries you a long way. It's the word consider. Consider. What does that mean? To consider someone else. To make consideration for them. This consideration is simply this: thinking more of each other than yourself. The greatest enemy of marriage is selfishness, deceitfulness, and distrust. And the picture of the heart that is committed to God's design for marriage is this: love which is happy to serve, wanting to understand, and willing to forgive. Father God, thank you for this gift of marriage and family. Lord, thank you for giving us direction. Help us to live by your word. Lord, help us as a church to stand for your word and your design for marriage and family. And Father, I pray for young people in our church, those graduating from high school, those just out of high school. Lord, that as they make some major decisions in the decade ahead, I pray that they will look to you for guidance and wisdom and leadership for those decisions. Lord, help all of us, young and old, to just seek to be the right person, committed to you, made righteous.